Imagine if you could go to the grocery store this morning and you walk in and you see people and you say, good morning, brother. Good morning, sister. How is your progress towards awakening today? How's it going today in your progress towards awakening? And they would say, you know, I forgot to work on it this morning. I say, well, be sure to work on it when you get home, okay? Or they might say, well, I spent a couple hours this morning. Great. And they'll say, how's your progress going? I say, well, I did a taping this morning. I spent a couple hours in contemplation this morning already. And they say, fantastic. Keep it going. You meet somebody else. Hello, brother. There's no strangers there. See, there's no strangers. Where I live, everybody's a stranger. Everybody's a stranger, you know. Everybody's in their own world. The fact is we share a common world, the world of awakening, the world of the responsibility to awaken from the dream, to recognize the I am presence of isness through unconditional love that is simply there, and that we are lost in this hypothetical scenario of the belief that we can create a power greater than reality that can then force reality to change. We're lost in that dream. We need to awaken from that dream. The I am presence, the isness of reality, the isness of our identity is always there, not being changed at all. It's there for us to experience, to abide in. And so we all share that common goal, that common responsibility. Everybody does. And yet everyone's so asleep, they're not able to communicate that way. It's unbelievable to me. I cannot fathom the depth of slumbers, you know. For me, when you see somebody, I just want to say, hey, we say, how's it going? Hey, how you doing? How you doing? That's about it. Say, how's it going today? You know, with your, you know, progress towards awakening, with your clarification towards awakening. It should be something like that. How's your clarity towards awakening coming today? In other words, we support and remind each other of what our goal is each day, and so we won't lose track of it. That's what a spiritual community, religious community is all about. Everyone you meet will remind you, you know, how are you, how's it going today? How are you feeling? You've got some momentum going today? And if you say, well, you know, it's kind of rough, I feel sluggish, they, you know, give you a pat on the back, say, hey, hang in there. I know it's tough, but you still got to do it, so don't slack. Wouldn't that be fantastic? It should be completely normal here. It's just a completely amazing the world to me, the way that it is, how people waste their time, waste opportunity, is beyond belief. And it takes like someone who's perfectly awake to even, you know, interject a little bit of that, and it's like pouring water into a desert. It very quickly, you know, percolates down to the sand and is gone. And that's the situation that we're faced with here. It's the call to forgetfulness is so powerful here. The attraction, the siren song of forgetfulness is so powerful that we waste it. We waste our lives. That is a fact. So I'll say good morning to you. How is your clarity towards awakening going today? For me, usually I wake up in the morning, it's either I feel a lot of momentum, or else it seems like I've forgotten everything. I have to start from scratch all over again. It's terrible. Today is one of those days having to start from scratch all over again. And it, you know, sleep is it's overrated. We need it. I really need it to recharge. But at the same hand, it's like we seem to forget everything when we go to sleep. Kind of like when we're awake here in the waking time, we are very forgetful of the sleeping time. When we're sleeping, we're very forgetful of the waking time. And both the waking and the sleeping is very forgetful of the isness that we are. Extremely forgetful. So we got forgetfulness all around. And we need to continue efforts. It's like two steps forward, one step back. That's normal. Two steps forward, one step back. Very normal. We'd like the momentum to just continue on uninterrupted, but it doesn't seem to happen that way. You almost have to grab the threads again each morning and say, okay, what was I thinking of yesterday? I can't quite remember. I had a feeling like I was really getting there, and now I'm saying, I've forgotten what it is. You know, I had all these crazy dreams. I wake up, and, you know, where am I? I don't know what's going on. I can't remember. Whew, that is why it's very helpful to, for a culture to reinforce this. You know, what a amazing thing that would be. I always think there must have been some ideal time in history where this was true. You know, where there were entire cities and communities where everybody was on the same page as far as what their responsibilities really were. But that's probably not true. Probably not true. There might be some, you know, small communities where everybody's a member of a congregation of some sort. And, everyone greets one another. I remember going to a kind of a planned living community place, elder people, retired people, and everybody smiled at each other when they passed, said, good morning, how are you? Good morning, how are you? But it was very artificial because there was no depth to it. There was no inquiry, like, how is your inquiry going today? No, it was like, it was like being, we're very polite and respectful. How are you? It needs to go beyond that and say, some say, you know, that namaste, namaste, how is your inquiry going today? And I wish you a powerful inquiry today. You know, the idea of namaste, peace, is kind of peace to you. But we need to go beyond that, the namaste, actually. When we part, we say, my intention is for a tremendously powerful inquiry for you today. And the other say, I have the same intention for you, you know. It's like that. You know, how can that hurt? How can that hurt, right? How can that hurt anything? Is it somehow a problem with that? But where is that being generated? I know there's some teachers who tried to generate it within a small group of people, which perhaps at this time is the only thing that can be done. But it seems to be just a natural thing to support people's inquiry. Because inquiry has to be done. Has to be done. It's the one inescapable responsibility. Doesn't matter if you die, you don't escape that responsibility. Because dying doesn't solve anything. Okay? It just means that your car has worn out and it's in the junkyard now. You just buy another car. That's what you do. I mean, if your desire is to keep on driving, you just have to get another car. You get another body. That's a fact. That is an absolute fact. We all know that cars wear out, and at some point we trade them in and get a new car. It, you know, quits on us, and we say, well, we just can't quite fix this one, so just like that. And if the driver wants, there's a driver there, he says, I want to keep driving the car. Rebirth, for sure, into another car to drive. Car of forgetfulness, driving in the land of forgetfulness. See, if the desire is still to be prime creator, you have no choice but to continue your travels in the land of forgetfulness, the land of trauma, the land of ceaseless massacre, the land of a vast sacrificial system. You have no choice but to do that because that's the only place, the only way you can live out this fantasy that you're progressing towards being prime creator. It's the only way. There's no way to act out that fantasy if with awareness of reality at all. It's impossible. You would know instantly that you cannot change reality. There's no way. And you wouldn't want to either. So, as long as that idea has not been dropped, as long as that desire has not been dropped, you will reincarnate. You will get another car to drive. That is 100% for sure. And of course, we forget that too. I mean, we're so forgetful in this world, we can't even remember the cars we've driven, right? I mean, some of us can, you know, in our lives, we can look back and say, yeah, what did I start out with, you know? Oh, boy, see, I can hardly remember what I started out with. So I'm a Buick station wagon, maybe. I know I got a Volkswagen Bug, an old one, 1959 or something like that. Then I got an old 300,000 mile Mercedes that never worked, was a nightmare. Then I had a Plymouth Valiant, I think. What else? And then a truck, pickup truck. Okay, so we have these cars in our lives. How many of us remember the lives that we've had? You know, they're just like cars, just like vehicles that we're driving. That's all. I've been able to remember some of my lives. I saw that I've had many, many, many lives here, and just driving different vehicles through this, the land of sacrifice, the land of trauma. All of the lives traumatic, all of them difficult, miserable, suffering. And not once did death ever free me from that. How can death free spirit from a desire? Spirit has. Does death have some kind of power over spirit? The idea that death can somehow free us is itself a reinforcement of delusion, that there's some power over reality, that death can somehow strip spirit of its desire against its will. Not possible. Not possible. The death of a body doesn't touch the desire of spirit. Okay. Not at all. Effects don't have power over cause. They do not, and yet we are believing that. So if we believe that by dying we are free, we are believing that effects have power over cause, which just strengthens our delusion and therefore pulls us even more back into another vehicle here in this world to try and finish the job off, which can never happen. So it's very important to look at the desire to be prime creator and realize it's impossible. Cannot do it. So if you want to free yourself from the cycles of rebirth, you have to drop that desire to be prime creator. This is, Buddhism teaches a very similar. I have tremendous respect for the teachings of Buddha. I don't really study them because I have my own viewpoint, particular emphasis that I'm responsible for bringing through here. But it is very right on the money, I tell you that. definitely desire, the root of our cycles of rebirth, constant cycles of getting new vehicles, is based on our desire to be prime creator, be greater than God. That is our desire. As long as we have that, we have no choice but to continue on with our sacrifice, with sacrificing another vehicle. Because that's how we try to generate this power over reality, is through sacrifice, is through loss, is through death, is through trauma, is through suffering, is through negation. This whole universe is devouring itself continuously, and that's trying to develop the power of devouring reality, which can never happen. And as long as we want it to happen, we won't look at reality, we won't take a peek at it. I took a peek at it once, and I saw, oh my gosh, reality can't be touched. Cannot be devoured. That's it. And I realized at that moment, game over. I said, all this stuff we're doing is useless. It's a waste of time. Total waste of time. But, you know, how do you somehow disengage from that effort, you see, has been the quest. Once you see reality, then you're on a quest to disengage from this, you know, to drop this effort. You know that you will at some point, but you don't know exactly when or exactly how. And that's the spiritual path. You can't have a real spiritual path until you are willing to at least take a peek at reality. In other words, your honesty comes through. You say, well, let me at least see if it's possible what we're trying to do, right? Isn't that being honest? Let me at least see if it's possible. That's all I did. I said, let me see if this is possible. But the world has its agenda. And let me just double check and see if that's really possible. I took a look, experienced a moment of reality as it is, the isness. And I saw, it's completely untouched and untouchable. Can never be changed. Can never be corrupted in any way. And that was a complete certainty. It wasn't a conceptual thing. It was a knowing through and through. No doubt, zero doubt about it. And of course, belief doesn't believe that, because in belief, there's always doubts. And belief says nothing's set in stone. Everything can be changed. At least, we can believe everything can be changed, of course. So the land of belief, I call it the logic of plausibility too, is this delusion that we're in, this dream, this fantasy, this hypothetical scenario of plausibility, the land of belief where we can believe anything is possible. And by believing anything's possible, we can continue to believe that we can be prime creators. So we're living on a hope and a dream. We're living on a hope and a dream that one day we can become prime creator. We all have this dream that one day, my dreams will come true. And there's a million songs about that. And we romanticize it. It's all this spiritual, this whole thing is like a spiritual romance. And we think we're romancing the future and that one day, you know, my dreams will come true and we will finally succeed in being prime creator. And so we turn it into this great story, this great romance, this great journey, the romance of the journey, the evolution of consciousness. We're on this incredible journey together. And one day we will... we will succeed in reaching this perfection that we are aiming at. See, funny thing is though that we are already the perfection. We have always been that, and always will be that. There's no journey necessary. There's no story necessary. What we are doesn't need any story about it. It doesn't need any journey to it. It's already here. It's always been here. So we're just wasting our time, that's all. And when you waste your time, you need to romanticize it some way, right? Or you need to, how do you say that? Solemnize it? Solemnicize. I cannot say that word. So, need to, you know, make it very, very important, all important. Solemnicize it. So we do that. We somehow we make it appealing to us. Very important. We need to keep on this journey. But our real goal is to develop this power over reality. That is truly what we're trying to do in existence, and we hide that from ourselves by all sorts of excuses. Really, that is the truth. We got this guilty secret. You know, there's this mystery of existence. It's a guilty secret we all have, and nobody knows what it is. Except here, we do know. It is literally that we are working on trying to manufacture through process, some process, a power that is more powerful than reality and that can threaten reality with destruction. That is our guilty secret, the mystery of existence. That's what it is. And we obscure that through all sorts of window dressings. You know, it's kind of like we have these big shopping windows on a big store, and we got all this really fancy, beautiful stuff and jewelry and looking beautiful and interesting. And then the product, you know, there's only one product being sold, and it's a little product off in a corner, no light on it, and nobody recognizes it. And that little product, again, is this effort to create the power of destruction over reality. And so that's the only thing that we're really working on. Everything else is just distraction. We claim we're doing all this great stuff, and we're balancing the universe. We're bringing all the galaxies together. It's all a cosmic thing, and you know all this, you know, endless stuff that we're, you know, saving the day somehow. So we're vitally important to stay with this whole thing of developing consciousness because we're going to save the day and heal the universe and blah 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 blah. Ascended master saying this, channeling this, all this stuff. It's all nonsense. That's all distraction. That's not what the universe is about. The universe is our fantasy, our effort to manufacture. Again, it's not creating, but it's based on process. Creation isn't based on process. Creation is instantaneous manifestation, the expansion of isness. There's no process involved at all, in reality, none. So by trying to come up with a power greater than reality, we can't manifest everything. We have to work through what we call process. It's actually an illusion of process because we're manifesting every instant. But to perception, we don't see that at all. We cannot see it. So it seems as though there's this process taking place. Bodies born, bodies dying. Everything arising falls down again. Everything that we're given in the universe is taken away. We lose it. The universe gives simply to take away from us. The universe is ceaselessly devouring itself. Everything, every instant, there's trillions and trillions of life forms right here on this planet dying. Okay. from the biggest life forms, from to the elephants and the whales, you know, and the big sequoia trees and all this, down to the tiniest microorganisms and bacteria and fungus and, you know, decay. I mean, even decay is happening at a molecular level. Everything, you know, is decaying also. And then also there's this all this massive arising every moment as well of new forms that are set up, propped up to get, boom, you know, knocked down again. That's all the universe does. The universe props us up to poof, knock us down. It does that over and over and over again. We get a new car. We're driving it. That's great. And then kaboom, you know, accident. Uh-oh. And we obscure this. We say, no, you know, this is all some great, 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 great plan of God, that God is moving this whole universe forward somewhere. But where, it's a mystery, through some unknown higher or something. But truth is, the God of this universe is a complete failure, total failure. Doesn't help us in any way. We pray to this God, you know, help us, help us, help us, help us. No, we get propped up to get knocked down again, like that. Doesn't free us. The God of this universe doesn't free us from this universe. The God of existence doesn't free us from existence. There really isn't any God, therefore. A God that has no power like that is not a God at all. Because this is simply a fantasy. So what? Where is God in a fantasy? Where is God in a hypothetical scenario? Where is God in the denial of reality? Where is God in the attempt to destroy reality? It's not there. It's not there. The true God, the one and only God, the prime creator of reality, simply tells us to choose a new idea. Simply tells us to set down our desire to be prime creator. Just set it down and pick up the desire to not be prime creator. Very simple. And that then awakens us from this ridiculous dream of trauma, and we realize what we are has never been traumatized, has never been wounded, has never been diminished, therefore doesn't need any ameliorative efforts, doesn't need to be healed in any way, does not need any sort of therapy, has never been crazy, doesn't need any therapy, doesn't need any plan of healing, doesn't to be rejoined. It's not like there's all these parts out there and we need to rejoin them. That's kind of the belief of this cult consciousness thing, is that there's all these separate parts and somehow we have to bring all these parts and unite all these parts. Not true. Identity is not fragmented. We believe it is. So belief can believe that there's all these parts, but there aren't any. And the oneness was never fragmented. We have a dream of fragmentation, a belief in fragmentation. It's never been fragmented. So, what we are is not in need of anything. It's not in need. It itself is what it needs. It is what it needs already and always is. What reality is doesn't need anything else. It is everything already. So, it doesn't need a story of healing. Doesn't need a story of development. Doesn't need any of these stories that we keep spinning out in existence. Doesn't need anything to happen. Doesn't need anything to take place. Doesn't need anything to avoid or not take place. The dreamer doesn't need the dream, right? When we fall asleep and dreaming all this stuff, do we really need the dream? Do we really need that stuff, all that dream? No, we don't. We don't need the dream. And each day, we need reminders. We don't need the dream. We greet people. Have you woken up yet? Have you woken? Okay. Are you getting close to it? Are you working on it? You got some things clear? Have you got some insights? And we don't need to spend a lot of time blah, 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 blah. It's just that the motivation, reminding each other, you know, keep your motivation going, keep your motivation going, keep your motivation going, like that. Don't let your motivation drop on this day. That's all a reminder says. On this day, keep your motivation at an all-time high. Keep it up there, really good, really strong. And we don't need to be talking about the news, really. You know, if we can just shift the whole thing over to motivation towards realization, towards extending the invitation for the fragrance of business to permeate us. Keep that motivation going every day, and you have to work at it. It's something everybody should work at, because it's something everybody has to do. There's no way to wiggle out of this. Again, death does not remove that obligation from you. So why wait for your death? You know, I see everybody simply waiting for their death. I go into a store where I go around all the time, every day. I'm moving around to different places and different businesses and all over the place. And never do I catch even a glimpse of anybody, you know, who's working on it. You know, if they are, it's deeply hidden. We don't need to, you know, go around like in secrecy, like we're, you know, doing something terrible. No, we have one responsibility here in this world, and that is to realize that paradoxically we don't have any responsibility to what is, because what is doesn't need any external responsibility, doesn't need anyone responsible for it. It is inherently responsible. We don't need to weave a story for it, okay? We don't need to be story weavers. We don't need to be dream weavers. Not at all. And so we can remind ourselves of that. Are you dropping? You know, we're responsible to see that we're not responsible. That is our one responsibility. Since we took on the belief that somehow we're going to be greater than God, greater than reality, we feel that we have to work on this responsibility of how do we relate then to reality. There's no need for something to relate to reality. Reality is self-relational, inherently so. So we're not responsible to heal reality. It doesn't need any healing. We're not responsible to straighten reality out. It doesn't need any straightening. We're not responsible to complete reality and make it holy. It's already holy. It can't be otherwise because there's no parts to it. It can't lose anything. Isness is not something that's bolted together like a robot, you know. We're not responsible even to realize reality. Reality is not dependent on some realization. It already is. So ultimately, we're responsible because we took on this dream. We're responsible in the dream to realize we're not responsible. We have no responsibility. Reality doesn't require responsibility. And we don't have to establish a relationship. Reality doesn't need a relationship. It already is inherently one. So what need does that for relationships? We don't need to establish a relationship with what we are. So it's important to turn this around, you know, to take that final step of realizing we don't need any path. We don't need any realization. We don't need any invitation. We don't need to do anything at all. We don't need to do anything for reality to be what it already is. And to remain as that, we don't need to do anything at all. But we do need to get to this clarity. We have to do it. So that is the responsibility. We do have a responsibility of recognizing that we don't need to do anything, because we have this massive belief that we're supposed to do something, and it gets amplified constantly being amplified. Since I've been in the world, it's been amplified to immeasurable extent that we must do something. And everybody is frantically, you know, doing all sorts of stuff. Now we have all these gadgets that everybody's, you know, in their smartphone, you know, they're doing something constantly. Now, of course, we have the practical, pragmatic things of life, but it's an attitude that we're talking about. It's attitude of realizing, oh, I don't need to do anything to be what I already am. And when we can thin this attitude out to a certain extent, somehow, it's like a pressure system shifting. I was one time at the beach, and it was a sunny day, and gradually the atmosphere, the waves were pounding, a lot of spray was coming from there, and the air got more and more filled with moisture, and began getting cooler and cooler and cooler, and it became miserable, just dense, atmosphere, you know, and so we decided we're going to leave, you know, the sun was like almost blotted out by this heavy, humid, cold, clammy, you know, atmosphere. It's terrible. And so we decided we're going to wait for like 5 more minutes, you know, or 5, or was it 15, maybe 15 minutes, something like that. Just, I don't know why we decided that. And suddenly a little trickle of breeze kind of came through from some other direction. Before, all the air was blowing in from the ocean. Okay, it was an onshore breeze going on towards the shore. Then this little trickle of breeze came through, and it was kind of warm. And we said, "What is that? Where did that come from?" And then we kind of went back to, you know, it's me. Look at this horrible day. It's ruined. And then another little breeze, you know, went through like that. And we kind of said, huh, there it is again. Oh, well, just kind of some anomaly. And then this gentle breeze came through where we were sitting, an offshore breeze, very gentle, and it continued this time. It didn't stop. It was very gentle at first. And we say, oh, what a marvelous breeze that is. It's warm. Thank God, because we're freezing here. Such a cold day. And then it picked up. It got stronger and stronger and stronger. And at some point, it actually blew our umbrella away and carried it out to the shore. I had to go chasing after it. And it got really strong. And it was this wonderfully warm breeze out of nowhere. It was just incredible. The breeze kept coming and coming and coming. And it literally totally cleared up the atmosphere. And the sun was like the most beautiful sun you've ever seen. It was just crystalline, sparkling. And the day was like, the atmosphere was perfect. It was the most mind-blowing thing I think I've ever experienced on this planet. What happened was a warm inland pressure system had been building up. The heat was building up. And at some point, it was heavy enough to push all this cold air mass out to sea. It pushed it out to sea. And in its place was just a sparkling clarity. And we were stunned. It was, people were just like beside themselves, like euphoric. Because it happened so quickly. Excuse me. Happened so quickly and very unexpectedly. And to this day, you know, that's an unforgettable experience. And so, this is an analogy for when we realize we don't need to do anything. For what we are to be what it is. I don't have any responsibility towards reality whatsoever. That's like we've thinned it out, and we've piled up this huge pressure system of clarity that at some point the balance has tipped, and this gentle breeze, the fragrance of remembrance, the presence of isness will waft through us, we will be aware of it. And then it'll, you know, gradually, gently increase. I've had a few moments of this gentle breeze. It comes like maybe just briefly, and then it's gone, and then briefly again. At some point, it's a steady breeze. And that will just push away all the trauma. It'll push everything away, and you'll be left just with this stunning clarity, just a sparkling clarity. So that is really what we are going towards, is this sparkling clarity, a clarity in trauma-free, loss-free, seamless, you know, just this buoyant, you know, elation that we don't have to do anything about. It's just there. Because what we are has never been diminished in the slightest bit by all our attempts to find a way to diminish it. Okay, we've been trying to find a way to diminish it. None of those attempts have been successful, and never will. And that has not been diminished. And it is not afraid of us. It's not going to hold something back, thinking, I better not give this dream figure too much power, because if it does, it might be able to destroy me. No, it's not like that. Just a minute, I'll be right back. So it's been my experience of foreshadowing in this world that there is a situation that will arise for us once we get enough clarity that there's nothing we need to do, there's no responsibility we need, there's no realization we need. Really, that's when we get to that point where we're able to speak about this and share this. And it's not just a conceptual exercise, but it is sort of a felt, yeah, I get it. When we get to that point, we know we're very, very close. The situation is extremely thin, and this pressure system is ready to move in and move all that, the memories of trauma and the future desires to participate in trauma, to move it all out. Sweep it clean, really clean. Effortlessly, there's nothing we need to do. You know, we were just sitting on the beach, just experiencing this and laughing. It was like, are you kidding me? I mean, the experience was like, are you kidding me? You got to be kidding. This is incredible. This horrible atmosphere was simply being pushed out to sea, leaving us in this sparkling, beautiful experience. It's like we had to pinch ourselves. Is this some kind of dream, you know? And it will be like that. It's like, wow, everything, all this crud is being pushed far, far away, never to return. All this crud. And all we have to do is simply abide in that, as Ramana Maharshi said, simply abide in that. And just enjoy it. You don't have to be helping it out. You know, it's taking care of business, taking care of what needs to be taken care of automatically. So when we realize that we don't need any realization, no realization is necessary, no realization required, no remembrance required, no process, remembrance of process required, no responsibility required for this. We're not responsible for ourselves, what we are. We're not responsible for reality. Reality itself is responsible for itself. There's not some other agency that's responsible for it. You see, we're locked into this dream of that we're going to be greater than reality. So somehow we have to be responsible for it. So we think if something like this happens, this current, this fragrance, excuse me, this fragrance of remembrance comes, we think, okay. Now, how did we generate this, and what process did we use, and how is this a product of my consciousness? How is this a product of our consciousness? Reality is not a product of consciousness. Okay. We keep talking about consciousness. That is a symbol. It's a dream. Reality is not based on consciousness. Reality is not a product of consciousness. It doesn't arise from consciousness. So we don't need to come up with an answer. We don't need an answer. We don't need an answer. We don't need a realization. We don't need a recognition. We don't need to do anything. We don't need anything to happen. We need to do nothing, nothing at all. And we get to this, keep focusing on this. It's thinning out the situation. It's building up this willingness to come through. It's building it up. And we have to do that because we're in this belief system, because we have belief, we do have to at least go through the motions like this. We're responsible to focus on recognizing we're not responsible. We need to recognize that we don't need any recognition. You see, there is that direct kind of canceling type of thing. It's not really a paradox, it's a canceling out. Whereas we're looking at everything that we thought we had to do, and we're saying, no, we don't need to do that. We don't need to do that. We don't need to do that. Because as long as we keep believing we have to do it, do something, this fragrance of remembrance will not come to us, because we will try and immediately put it into the context of a product that existence is somehow manufacturing. And then that will just cause us to go to freak out in some way and go into a severe side trip. Which is why you never want to force it. You never want to try to force it. It's not forcible in the first place, but when you try to force something, you're going to automatically, whatever experience arises, you're going to try and put that into context of existence, context of consciousness, context of process, all that. You're going to try and integrate it into that. And that is just going to put you on a very, very unwelcome side trip, I'm telling you. No, the non-dual teachers each has their own emphasis, okay, but they're certainly knocking on that door. They're certainly helping thin things out, which is what is necessary, however you want to do it. You get to that point, you say, no realization required at all. That's thinning the situation out. That's putting yourself in a state that says, I don't need to put this into any context. I don't need to set this into, I don't need to find what process led to this. There's no process that led to it. It is a realization that no process is required. All right. Now, there was a process to get to that realization that no process is required, but once you go past that, there is no process required, you see. So you don't have to set it into a context of process, a context of realization, context of enlightenment. There's no enlightenment required. No nirvana required, no samadhi required. No mantras required, no meditation, no contemplation, no process, no effort required. No responsibility required. Unconditional. No conditions required. It's entirely unconditional. Reality is unconditional. What could it be setting conditions for? Is there something outside of reality it needs to set conditions for? Certainly reality doesn't need to set conditions for reality. Being created within the laws of the prime creator, it already is that. So it doesn't need some requirements. So it's basically realizing that reality is what it is, and it simply is, and there's nothing needs to be done with that in regard to that at all, except to abide in that. And so there's a lot of teachings in the world that are helpful, for sure. No question about that. Each one seems to have a different emphasis, because each one sees things in a slightly different way. You know, I cannot effectively share in the way that someone else shares, because I have my own clarity and emphasis about the totality of the situation. But you will also hear a lot of similarities, because it's very similar. There's nothing you need to do. There's nothing you need to do. And then basically what the teaching does is just state all the things that you don't need to do. Remind you that when we say there's nothing that you need to do, this is what it means. Because we always have like some exception, like, okay, there's nothing we need to do, but surely they don't mean this. I mean, they're not talking about this, right? I mean, surely we have to realize that, you know, right? I mean, no realization required. And it, you know, they get into, well, there's no one to realize, you know, stuff. Well, I don't emphasize that. It's like, I'd say that it's more, from my standpoint, it's more that no realization is required. And so if no realization is required, there's not some me that needs the realization, right? And yet the experiencing of the fragrance of isness still seems to be happening to identity, you know. It's just that it's not a needy identity. It's an abiding identity. It's an identity that is enjoying this. There is an enjoyment of it, sure. But there's not a struggle to realize the enjoyment. There's not a struggle to integrate the enjoyment into concepts and form and process, right? The universe is all this process. How could it not be a process? Because first it has to raise everything up, then it has to devour it, and then raise it up again, devour it. So it's, you know, waves like this, waves of rising up and devouring. And they go like this, and they go like this, and we call that the play of consciousness, like that, arising and falling, arising and falling, like that, always like that. So of course there's process in this belief system of we're developing a power over reality. And how are we doing it? By this process. First there's something, and then this something is devoured, and we keep thinking like we're like we're enriching some uranium or something, you know. You put it through all this enrichment processes, you know, getting more and more enriched, and at some point we think it'll be catalyzed and kaboom, we're gonna have this power over reality. And then we can go to force the prime creator to the bargaining table and say, okay, here, you know, this is our offer, take it or leave it. Either you make us change reality, make us prime creator, or we're going to put the hammer down and we're going to negate all of reality. You won't have anything. So we don't have to integrate it with this dream. Don't have to integrate it in the dream at all. And we don't have to not integrate it either. It doesn't matter. There's no effort. Whatever happens, happens. As far as how it shines in the dream, it simply shines in the dream. It's not trying to integrate itself in the dream. And the greatest teachers are just like that. They just shine and just laugh and just sit here. They're not trying to start any religion. They're not trying to integrate anything. They're not trying to do anything at all about anything, really. They're also not trying to not do anything, you know. If something, you know, happens, it happens. But they simply are shining this, I need do nothing. Nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to happen here. Nothing. Nothing at all. And nothing needs to not happen either. Reality is free and clear of anything supposedly external, because there is nothing external to it. It's free of all requirements. There are no external requirements. There's no power greater than reality or outside of reality. There's nothing outside of reality. Even this dream that there is something outside of it, or there will be something outside of it eventually, is not outside of it. So we are engaged in this last third of 2012, which is a very important time. And if you're spending time watching this video or other videos from other sources, you're spending your time well, because it is a most important time. Because the changes that will happen, the situations that are happening, are really offering you a false path, a very strong, attractive, false path. And if you don't key in to the real path, which is to realize you don't need any path at all, there is no path to the self. Krishnamurti said, truth is a pathless land, right? It's very high teachings. You don't need a path to be where you already always are, right? But the path, you need a path to recognize that you don't need a path. You need a realization to realize that you don't need realization, any realization. And the false path is what the world is offering, the dream is offering. It's being marketed to an unbelievable extent in the world right now. And so if you are not able to key in on this, certainly you're going to be acted in off to this false path, which is a real big time waster, A lot of trauma on that path, a lot of sacrifice, a lot of suffering, as you might expect. And my gosh, when I see those who have been caught up in this, some of the so-called higher consciousness entities, etc., who are caught up, have been caught up in this, and they think they've made a lot of progress, and oh my gosh, they're so caught up in these melodramas of it all. You know, the story, the romance of consciousness. They're so caught up in it. You know, they don't... It's sad. It's sad. And it's frightening. It's like a cautionary tale that you can get this inflated belief in that you're somehow elevating something. That you're so wrapped up in that, elevation of something, that you simply cannot see where you really are, already are. You cannot allow that fragrance of remembrance of isness to permeate you, because you will then, if that starts happening, you'll say, oh my gosh, another opportunity to elevate. Okay, how am I going to, harness this energy and elevate consciousness even more? See, that is the problem, isn't it? If you think you need to elevate something, and you need to elevate consciousness, when you get this breeze of freedom, you will interpret it as if it's some kind of energy that you then need to utilize to elevate consciousness more. And you will then feel as if you have an opportunity, a gigantic opportunity, and also a gigantic responsibility to find a way to use this energy to elevate consciousness. And therefore you will feel incredibly burdened, also incredibly inflated about your own importance vis-a-vis this elevation of consciousness. And it will be a nightmare, absolutely a nightmare. So this incoming fragrance of remembrance of isness, the presence, I am presence of isness, it only comes in where the invitation, where the opportunity truly is there, so that it doesn't bring about this terrible inflation of responsibility and belief, a false belief that you have some great mission, etc., etc. See? So it waits until we have seen through this facade of this dream of the elevation of consciousness. It waits till we've seen through that and will not arrive in in steady stream until we have seen through that. Otherwise, we would be completely freaked out and think that we'd say, oh my God, you know, that we'd say, I must be the, you know, the end all and be all. I must be in charge of this whole elevation of consciousness. I must be the one. In other words, excuse me, I need to take another drink here. And if this were to happen, you would say, oh, I must be the one. My gosh, I'm the one. What, you know, how am I going to have the world realize this? And I'm the one who can, I know what the energy is, how to elevate all consciousness into perfection. And oh my gosh, you know, terrible, terrible ruinous self-inflation and burden, responsibility, and all this nonsense. So it would just be, it would be brutal and traumatic beyond belief. So if you want to know why hasn't this fragrance of remembrance come to many in the world, because just because of this dynamic, that's it. That's all there is to it. And when we can see through this whole facade of this dream that we're dreaming and realize, see it all very clearly like this, then we will not take it in that way. We won't take it in a self-inflationary way of somehow there's this energy that we need to integrate and utilize to elevate consciousness. No, we realize that's not it at all. It's simply the shining of the isness, the fragrance of the isness, which is reality, which is identity. And it's simply shining. That is all it's doing. It's radiant, it's sparkling, it's clear. It is what it is. Doesn't need to be elevated. We don't need to elevate our subconsciousness to be what we already are. So you see, Ramana simply peacefully abiding. He just hanging out, right? Very quiet, not saying anything, just smiling, very peaceful. He's just experiencing us. That's it. Just shining, sparkling, radiant, you know, and people would come and say, wow, what's this? And people back then had the wisdom to simply realize, ah, okay, let me just sit here in quiet and just let my own story thin out. Let this false belief I have that something needs to be done thin out. Whereas today, we might see that and all these scientists would descend and say, okay, there's some sort of super energy here present in Ramana, and we need to hook up all these machines and resonant chambers, and let's do CAT scans, and let's do nuclear scans, and we'll put lasers and holographs and get all this stuff going, and we'll figure out, you know, where does this energy come from? How is it being generated? Is it some quantum effect? You know, how can it be applied to consciousness? You get that. You get this madness. So I think we're all reluctant in today's world to shine, because the lunatics will descend, you know, as it were. Like we'd have to go into hiding, you know. The scientists would descend upon you, and the quantum physicians would descend upon you, and the consciousness gurus would descend upon you and say, okay, we know that you, even if you don't say so, you are the one. You are the one. You have this energy, and we want it. We want to be able to use it for the good of all humankind, you know, for the good of the cosmos, for the good of the universe even. And if we can just figure out how to use this, we're going to save the whole universe. And they're going to, you know, poke and prod and, you know, get a hold of your bones, you know, and put them in some relic box somewhere. Start a church around it with the relics and all this nonsense, you know. So it's almost like you have to go into hiding. Almost, but I'm sure there's a way to get around that. but it's important to recognize that this is exactly it. I mean, people, the world will not, you know, most people will not take it the right way. They'll think, oh my gosh, you know, there's some super energy here. Super energy. No, it's the shining of identity. It's not an energy. It's not something external to reality. It's not something that needs to be integrated or brought to something. One way we hide what this dream is all about is thinking that we're working on a process of integration, that that consciousness is something, and then at some point we need to then integrate it with reality. So it will be a new reality because we are blended, you know, the true and the false will be blended, and a new truth will arise from the blending of the true and the false, of lies and truth. And we presume to be working on this, but that's just an excuse, a little excuse we're using to kind of deny that what we're really working on. You know, like we're, it's like you're working on a bomb, atomic bomb, and you're frantically trying to get an atomic bomb, and you tell the world, oh no, we're just working on energy, nuclear energy, that's all we're doing. It's a cover story. It's like that. It's a cover story. We say to the Prime Creator, oh no, we're not working on a way to try and destroy you. We're working on a way to try to integrate ourselves with you. To integrate consciousness with isness. But first we have to perfect consciousness. That's what we say. But what we're really trying to do is perfect this destructive power. And we're just using this story of perfecting consciousness to as a lie, as a cover story. As a cover story. And don't you think the Prime Creator sees through that cover story? Of course. It's a joke. It's funny. You say, we are, oh no, Prime Creator, only trying to perfect consciousness so that we can then integrate it with you and be greater than ever, and it's a wonderful thing. And we know that actually you are the one who are sponsoring all this whole story in the first place, right? And you don't want to say it because you're so humble, but we know that you're the one who's pushing this whole thing. You're the one who's responsible. You know, that's another joke. The Prime Creator is not responsible, is not pushing this idea of trying to develop a power to destroy itself. Not at all. It's spirit that is trying to do that. It's kind of like, you know, when children try to disguise themselves or hide, like when a cat tries to hide, you know, cat's sleeping somewhere and it thinks it's hidden, and you see it, and the cat will keep its eyes closed and just pretend. They say, like, well, if I can't see you, you can't see me. But once you see the cat, its cover is blown, and the cat will then get up and walk away and say, ah, they know where I am. You know, it's very funny. So we're pretending, you know, like we have our eyes closed. Say, well, we can't see God. God can't see us. So God doesn't know what we're doing. Our eyes are closed to what we're doing. So God must not be able to see what we're doing either. So when we open our eyes and say, oh my gosh, we're trying to manufacture this power to destroy reality. And we're using this cover story to say that we're really trying to perfect consciousness. And I can see it. And you say, well, if I can see it, God can certainly see it as well. All right, so we have this denial mechanism of, if we can't see it, we think nobody else can see it. You play that game, hide and seek, you know, and you're hiding somewhere, and someone's looking for you, and they see you, and they see you, and you say, uh-oh, and we like close our eyes and say, I can't see myself, I cannot see myself. Therefore, they cannot see me. You're hoping, and they tap you on the shoulder and say, I see you. And you keep your eyes closed. No. They keep tapping. So finally you say, oh my gosh, you know, got found out. It's exactly like that. We're using this defense of us insisting we can't see it. So how can anyone else, how can it be seen at all? You know, if we can't see it, it must not be there. That's like closing our eyes and saying we're not here. You know, we can't see anything, so we must not be here. We can't see anything around us, it must not be here. You know, It's silly. So it's far better to say, yeah, of course this is what we're doing. Of course we have this cover story. Of course, we're trying to cover up what we're doing. When you're trying to develop us this power that can destroy reality, of course we think we need to hide this effort and just say, oh no, this is just a consequence of developing our consciousness. And we've made up this belief in consciousness too, that that's just all part of belief as well. Isness doesn't have consciousness. It has isness. It's very different, you know. It's complete. It's always been complete. It's total. It's one. It's beyond unified. Unified is, what is that? Unified means there's things that without the unification would not be unified. That is nonsense. There's no, reality is not unified. It is one. And even beyond the concept of one, it is. There are no parts to be unified. The isness is seamless. It is seamless. So we don't need to develop unity consciousness. That's a cover story for our efforts to develop a power to destroy reality. It's a cover story, this whole thing about unity of consciousness. And we think, well, if we don't unify consciousness, how can we then integrate consciousness with reality? Again, reality doesn't need anything to be unified with it. Doesn't need anything to be integrated with it. It's not looking for some dream to be unified with it. So we just set the dream aside. We don't destroy the dream. We just gently set it on the side, on the back burner, then turn the flame off, you know, and just let it cool down. Just like you're cooking, you have a four-flame stove, and you got something on the front burner, you know, shift it off to the back burner, turn the flame down, and then let it cool, and at some point, turn the flame off, and just let it cool down. It's like turning off a fan. Click, turn off the fan. Fan blade's still going around, right? But it slowly gets slower and slower and slower. Just let it do that. Let it cool down. Don't need to turn the flame back on. You're not cooking anymore. No need to cook anything. You're not trying to cook up a dish. You know, season here, season this, and taste it and all that stuff. No. You're experiencing the fragrance of remembrance, and that is sufficient. You're not looking for something else. You're not looking to add something to it. You're not looking to slice it and dice it and add it to some other dishes. It's not some product to be cut up and distributed to other dishes that we're trying to cook up in consciousness. We simply experience it as it is. Not entertaining thoughts about what to do about it. Like, how can I use this? How can I cut it up? How can I dissect it? We're not trying to dissect it. We're not trying to put it under a microscope. We're not trying to make it an object of inquiry. Object of study. It's not a thing. It's not a dynamic, it's not a power, it's not an energy. It's not something that we need to study and gain insight into. So you might say, it's the end of insight. We don't need any insight. It's the end of clarity, we don't need any clarity. Isness is clear. It knows itself. It is. So no insight needed, no clarification needed. It's clear in itself. It is clarity. It's 100% clear, and even, you know, beyond that. And so again, we simply abide in it. And you can get a sense of the the fragility, sort of this presentation. Is that the world gives no support to it whatsoever. So as soon as you re-engage with the world, it seems like like this, this sharing never was, never took place. Because in belief, it can never take place within belief. It's beyond belief. So belief believes that it never took place. That's what I'm experiencing once I finish taping and I go out into the world, it's as if I never did the taping. It never took place. It's kind of shocking. I said, whoa, wait a minute. Never had these insights, never had these clarifications, never had this emphasis, never had this focus, never took place. So it's beyond forgetting. It's a denial saying it never took place at all. Because in belief, it never did. Because belief can never entertain this at all. So from its standpoint, if it's something it can never do, how could it ever take place, right? Reasonable, isn't it? If it's something that it can ever do this, then it will say, well, how could it take place? But that's assuming that the field of belief is all there is. Which is a false assumption. False premise. So we don't want to don't believe the false premise, or belief will believe the false premise, but we have to continuously drag ourselves back out of belief, beyond belief. And it's not easy, you know, it's like a discipline, which is why I try to do it most every day, because if you go too long, you start thinking, well, maybe I never did it in the first place. Maybe it never took place. Maybe I never had this clarity. It literally, I'm telling you, that is what happens. Because in when you reconnect with belief, it's not there. It is not there. And within belief, these great teachers never came into the world. They never came into the world. Which is why right now, you ask somebody, you know, on the street, if you do your street cam, which sometimes I've thought about doing, but haven't done it. And maybe it's not necessary, but if you did a street cam and asked somebody, hey, do you, you know who such and such is, or Mana Maharshi, or let's say, do you know who Ananda Mayamaya is? You know, I guarantee you that if you go to 100 people just randomly on the street, probably none of them would know, not one. And you could even do 100,000 and probably not one. And you could do 1,000,000 people, probably randomly, and you might not have a single one who would even know. Why? Because within belief, Ananda Maimon never came here. Within belief, never came here. Never happened. Within belief, it never happened. Okay. This is something profound we've gotten to. Now, if you've been watching this video so far, we've gotten to something very profound. It needs to be recognized because it affects you. It affects all of us. You may be very far along towards realizing you don't need realization. And you might be very close to abiding in the fragrance of remembrance. But you, like all of us, we accept belief to a certain extent. And within that belief, you haven't made any progress whatsoever towards awakening. Within that belief, there is no such thing as awakening. Within that belief, you are simply a product of belief. Within that belief, there's never been any great teachers come to show us the truth. Within belief, none of that is possible. And so you will doubt yourself. You will doubt yourself. You will doubt that there's even any goal to reach. You'll doubt it. And then you'll think, why should I even go back and listen more? Because it's a waste of my time. Because it's all folly. It's all scam. It's nothing there. Nothing there. Belief will believe there's nothing there. Never has been anything there. Belief will. So there is the problem. And then when you go back and you connect and you say, oh my gosh, how could I have possibly forgotten? And you say, yeah, I am close. You know, I'm closing in. I'm thinning it out. And I can simply abide. And then you go back to belief, and you say, huh? You forget all about it, that you ever did anything. I can easily forget 56 years of effort in this world, nonstop. All I have to do is start, reconnect with belief and start working, and I will literally be unaware that I've ever done anything. No awareness of it, no consciousness of it, belief doesn't believe it. See, belief does not believe it's possible. And if it's not possible, then all efforts are equally futile. And why should it believe any of them? It doesn't. There's a hummingbird. Wow, beautiful hummingbirds right here. Come on into the picture here, hummingbird. Wow. Do you hear that? Wow. Ruby-throated hummingbird just came up right here within about 18 inches of my face. I think you might have been able to hear the wings there. Yeah, I hope you could hear the wings and the chirp, 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 chirp. It was looking at me like I was a flower. So, this is really profound. That's why the path is so difficult. And belief doesn't believe in it. It thinks you're wasting your time. It thinks you're crazy. And it thinks it's doing you a favor by completely forgetting about it. And by ignoring it. It ignores all your attempts to thin out the belief in responsibility. The belief that something needs to happen. The belief that you need to do something. All your efforts to thin that out. It ignores them. It downplays. Tries to get you to forget them because it thinks you're on a impossible quixotic quest, that you're simply on a fool's errand, and it's doing you a favor by helping you forget it. Wow, that is very, very true. Because belief believes in belief. Belief believes in the goals of belief. Believes that's the only way. The only way is to succeed in manufacturing a power over reality. And there is no other way other than that. So of course it is going to forget any efforts to actually drop the whole dream. Drop the effort. Drop the desire to be prime creator. It will forget all that. It will not hold it in belief at all. Poof, gone, evaporate. So that is why the path is so important to work at it every day. And even then it's very difficult because it seems like you have to pick up from nothing, from scratch. I wake up in the morning this morning, it's like I've never done anything in my whole life towards the realization that no realization is needed. Like I've never done any thinning out, nothing. And then have to pick up the threads and go at it again. And if you don't have, you know, tremendous determination, it is incredibly easy to feel like, you know, why even try? That's ridiculous. It's not getting anywhere. Now you can see why the path is so important. The path to the realization that no path is needed is so important to work at it every day, to continuously work at it and make it a discipline. Otherwise, again, if you don't do it, you will literally forget that you ever put any effort into it in the first place, ever. It doesn't matter if you've been working at it your entire life. Belief will forget all about all those efforts, 100%. Forget all about them and think it's doing you the greatest favor possible. And so you have to disengage from that disbelief, you know. What belief is, forgetfulness of belief. You have to disengage and say, no, that can't be right, and then get back to it. And then you realize, yes, I have. Yes, I have. Yes, I have been working at it. Wow. This is very stunning. You know, it's instead we have an adversary. Now I see the adversary in all its stark forgetfulness. And it is an implacable adversary. It's an adversary that believes that its highest good is to get us to forget that we ever made any efforts at all, to completely forget what we're trying to reach. It's trying to get us to totally forget that. It's an implacable adversary. My gosh. All the more reason to allow the fragrance of isness to come in. You see, I'm going to have to process this. Okay, and I will do that. Because I see now that seeing this, it could be totally beneficial. Totally beneficial. Realizing that the stream of the fragrance of remembrance needs to be continuous. Otherwise, we will literally forget that it ever happened and have to battle to try and remember that. Okay, I'm going to process this. You'll be hearing from me again for sure. Okay, very great. That's it for this video. Stay with it.